Q A Yu55. It's an asteroid that is coming to Earth, flying by about 9/10 the distance of Earth and the Moon, and it's about 400 meters in diameter, so quite large, about the size of an aircraft carrier. This is coming by on November the 8th, and it will be flying by the Earth, and astronomers and observers will be watching for it. To fill us in on it right now is the principal investigator, Lance Benner. Here's a story.
2005 YU55 is going to make a very close approach to the Earth on the night of November 8th, 2011. At that time, its distance from Earth will be just under 9/10 of the Moon's distance away from us. It's going to be moving very rapidly as it traverses the sky near the Earth on November 7th, 8th, 9th, and 10th. In effect, it'll be moving straight at us from one direction, and then it'll go whizzing by and straight away from us in the other direction. So its motion across the sky will be close to 180 degrees over the course of less than 2 days. 2005 YU55 cannot hit Earth, at least over the interval that we can compute the motion reliably, which extends for several hundred years. It made a close approach to Earth about 18 months ago. In April of 2010, colleagues of ours at Arecibo Observatory were able to observe this asteroid using the radar facility at Arecibo. And they were able to obtain radar images that showed that this object is about 400 meters across. On November 8th, 9th, 10th, we'll be observing it again. This time with both the Arecibo telescope and with the Goldstone telescope here in California. This is the closest approach by an asteroid that large that we've ever known about in advance. The radar telescopes that we use to observe asteroids are very large radio dishes. The Goldstone telescope is 70 meters, which is 240 feet across, so it's truly enormous, and Arecibo is even larger still. The Goldstone telescope has a new radar imaging capability, which has just become available, that will enable us to see much finer detail than has previously been possible. And depending on how we transmit the signal, we can get different types of data. It shows us how big it is, it can show us features on the asteroid, it can tell us information about the asteroid's rotation period. We should be able to tell much better with these new observations that we're going to do.
All right, with me now is Marina Brosovich. She is a co-investigator with Lance and also a member of the radar team. And Marina is going to fill us in on exactly how do they get this data and this information about an asteroid just like YU55. So first of all, just to reiterate, a question that we are getting over and over in emails, on Twitter, and in chat, will this asteroid hit Earth? And we did hear it once before, but just to reiterate.
No, absolutely, it is not going to hit us. We have very good idea about its orbit for the following 100 years, and there is no chance of impact. And we believe with these measurements, upcoming measurements at Arecibo and Goldstone, we believe that we are going to remove this threat even further, probably centuries. For many centuries, we'll know exactly where this object is going to be.
This is such a terrific opportunity. This is a time where it's a very or fairly large, an average size asteroid, 400 meters. You know where it is, you know when it's coming. It's an excellent opportunity for observers to be standing by, ready to watch, ready to learn from it. So you watch and learn using radar, and exactly how do you do that?
Yes, so we are going to study this asteroid by using both Arecibo radar and Goldstone radar, and we are going to have a small video of showing exactly how do we learn about asteroids based on the radar images.
All right, so we're going to show straight to you.
Okay, so I'm going to tell you exactly how we use radar to learn about asteroids. Currently, we have only two planetary radars in the world. One is Goldstone in California, and the other one is Arecibo in Puerto Rico. So scientists use radar to ping asteroid and to learn its exact location and line of sight velocity. This allows us very precise orbital calculation. And we also use radar to obtain high resolution radar images of these asteroids that knows to be hundreds of thousands, even millions of kilometers away. So imagine that a radar is a very simplified, like flashlight, but instead of the visible light is transmitting microwaves, and you see microwaves are right between somewhere infrared and radio waves. And so we are transmitting these microwaves, they're moving at the speed of light, they're bouncing off the asteroid. We have this echo, and this radar echo is containing information both about surface features of the asteroid as well as its rotation. Here I'm showing you just how the really radar image looks like, and I'm going to tell you very simplified, this is not your regular, this is not your optical image. So here is how it works. We transmit the beam and we time the round trip time to the asteroid and back. We know the speed of light, that's how we know exactly the distance from the radar to the asteroid. This pink line shows you that. Notice that the front of asteroid is closer to the radar than the sides. We also have the information about rotation. If it's rapidly rotating asteroid, the echo is wider. If it's slowly rotating asteroid, the echo appears narrower. Once again, I'm repeating in a summary what you saw on that radar image. What we see on the horizontal axis is really the width of the echo in frequency. And on the vertical axis, you're measuring how far each little feature on that asteroid is far away from radar. Here is a side-by-side example. This is how you would see it with your camera. You take a snapshot with your camera. And then here's the radar image. And notice that radar is taking the image exactly in the perpendicular plane to your regular camera. Again, here I'm showing you how if the asteroid was rotating faster, the echo would appear wider. And again, if you are looking at the asteroid that's rotating relatively slowly, then it appears narrower. Here is again, notice that in this plane, in this radar line of sight, you have features from the northern hemisphere lit by radar and the southern hemisphere lit by radar really superimposed. Imagine if this were Earth. If this were Earth, this would be its radar image. You would not know which landmass belongs to the northern hemisphere and which one belongs to the south hemisphere, because it's in this completely different, it's in this perpendicular line of sight. But luckily, we have ability to untangle this so-called north-south radar ambiguity. But that's another story.
So, you know, we're so entrenched in seeing things optically with our eyes, because that's how we take pictures with our own cameras. I mean, that's how most people see things. And that is how much light comes into the aperture, how much light so you can visually see it.
Mm-hmm.
But you mentioned that you bring your own light. It's like having a flashlight. Can you explain how that works?
So optical telescopes, they really depend on the sunlight being reflected from the object.
Right.
But in our case with the radar, we bring our own flashlight. So imagine that this is the radar and this is the asteroid. And so we'll be shining this radar beam at the asteroid. And it's active technique. And we are bouncing off the beam of light and then receiving the echo back, and then the computers are processing this received data, and we finally built an image. We build an image of that asteroid.
So if you are at Palomar Observatory, you have to wait until nighttime to be able to see the stars, to see an asteroid. In a case like you, where you bring your own light,
you get to be daytime astronomer and you get to sleep at night. So,
very good.
So yes, well, we also have night tracks. A lot of times, it all depends when really the object is crossing the beam, the telescope beam, the radar beam. And Goldstone, for instance, it has 80% coverage of the sky. So we can track objects for many number of hours, 7-8 hour tracks. And at Arecibo, we wait also for the object to come into its beam, which is much kind of, Arecibo can steer, but it's much more powerful telescope. So really, we schedule our tracks dependently on availability of the time. It depends basically how the telescope has available time, and obviously when you can see the object.
But then you have that much more observation time. You don't have to wait until nighttime to be able to see things, and you have that much more opportunity to see things, don't you?
Yeah, well, it's comparable. You know, I was just at Palomar and I spent 13 hours at the telescope, so that's quite a long time to observe something.
All right. Well, as I said, we are here to answer your questions via chat, as well as some of the questions that were sent to us via email and Twitter. and Facebook. So the first question is from Jeff. It was an emailed question. Will 2005 YU55 be visible in the night sky as it passes Earth?
You will need a small telescope. So this is still a very small object. 400 meter is, I would say, a moderate size asteroid, but it's still small, very far away.
Okay.
So you need about at least 6-inch telescope in order to be able to observe it, and you'll see it as this like buzzing really, really fast across the sky.
And because it is so quick, I mean, you would probably, even though you do have a telescope, would have to know exactly where to look. You would have to have the coordinates, would you?
Yes. The coordinates for this object are widely available on many amateur astronomers' websites, sky telescope, or anything like that. So I'm sure that they have very detailed predictions. Where can people point their telescopes to?
Okay, here's a question. Now, this one's from the chat. It's from Laura Tendella, and where is the best time and location in California to view?
For that, I think it's best to check with sky telescope for optical observations, or check with any, with space weather. All of them are going to have detailed information much better than I can give you.
Okay.
So I only know when my radar, where our radar tracks are scheduled, but.
But we should be able to see it.
Absolutely, yes.
On November 8th, I'm told, is the best
time. November 8th becomes a nighttime object, and that's the time when you can see it.
But you start observing even sooner than that, don't you?
Yes. Our actually first radar track is scheduled already this Friday.
Okay.
So in the morning, we're going to be observing it with Goldsun for about 2 hours.
Right. I was told that it's coming in the direction
from the sun.
So anybody trying to look at it wouldn't be able to see it anyway,
yes,
because
yes.
It's looking
it's
directly
daytime.
Into the sun.
Yes, it's
okay, here's another question from, I think it's Top Turtle. I'm not sure. Perhaps you would be able to answer this. Does the UNESCO tsunami exercises and the first ever nationwide emergency broadcast system indicate there is some concern of an impact?
I'm absolutely sure that it has nothing to do, because there's no chance of impact. So whatever they're doing, it has nothing to do with this asteroid.
All right. I ate your neighbor is the other handle. Does the USA have a monopoly on radar or any other observations?
Well, these two radars happen to be in United States territory, but our SIBO is accepting observing proposals from I believe that it can be international collaboration, but. But yeah, for now, the radar community is really small and it's localized in the United States. But that doesn't mean that interest for radar observations are not there, and that other places in the world are planning maybe there to expand their capabilities.
And one final question from the chat is SJD394. If the asteroid was to hit the moon, what would happen?
I'm not familiar with that asteroid. And I'm sure that Don Yeomans can answer better that question than I can. I absolutely am not familiar with that object.
But like you, by the same token that you know that it won't hit Earth, because you've been able to track it.
Was
you know,
this the same object? You
yes,
read me?
They're asking for this, if this asteroid was
to hit.
You said SJ. Oh, no, that's their handle.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yes, I misunderstood.
I thought
yeah.
We are suddenly talking about some new asteroid.
No, this is the person who sent the question.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So if it were to hit the moon, and there's...
No, there's absolutely no chance that it's going to hit either Earth or Moon. So we know very precisely where the subject is going to be for, as I said, at least another 100 years, and there are no chances of impact.
And how are you able to do that? How are you able to look ahead for several hundred years exactly where this asteroid was going to go?
Well, this asteroid was discovered in 2005, and it's been 6 years. We built a very long observational data arc about this object. And also we have radar measurements, and radar measurements are very precise. You get to know where the object